I suppose, first of all, good afternoon, everybody. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to moderate what I hope is going to be a really useful panel discussion over the next 40 minutes or so. And I think you'll all agree that we've had some great insights already this morning around the political complexity of what lies ahead in terms of Brexit, the challenges being faced by a number of the client companies in the room here, as highlighted by the results of the Brexit Barometer. We've got a really good sense from James about the UK market and how things are changing there and the rapid rate of change that we're seeing happening there. And obviously then from Dean in terms of the supply chain implications of what may lay ahead for us. What we're going to try and do now over the next 40 minutes or so is spend a little bit more time, I suppose, looking at how Brexit is affecting the day-to-day planning and activities of some of the food and drink companies that we work with on a daily basis. And I suppose explore some of the practical steps that we believe companies can be taking over the coming weeks and months to try and get Brexit ready, if you like, as much as we possibly can. And maybe dig in a little bit more then to the supply chain implications, maybe that Dean started talking about a little bit. I'm delighted that we have a really strong panel that have agreed to take part here today. I think I'm hoping that they will help us make some more sense of everything that we've heard this morning and obviously share with us their own unique perspectives and experience as well. First of all, we have Alison Couser, and Alison is co-founder and indeed marketing and innovation director of East Coast Bakehouse, a large-scale manufacturer of a range of cookies and biscuits that are destined for the Ireland market, the UK, and indeed European market as well. And as well as that, it's very clear, looking at your bio, Alison, you have a long history of working with SMEs with high potential growth. So I think you bring a unique perspective in terms of from an SME level right up to that larger scale operation. How do you deal with these types of challenges that we're going to have to deal with around Brexit? So, Alison, if you wouldn't mind joining us, that would be great. We're joined as well by Jim Wolfe, who many of you know is CEO of Dairy Gold, also chairman of Dairy Industry Ireland. Dairy Gold as an entity obviously processes in the region of 1.2 billion litres of milk every year, as one of the largest producers that we have of cheddar cheese in Ireland. So if any sector is facing challenges around Brexit, I think, Jim, you'll be able to give us some really useful insights into how you maybe protect your position in the UK and also look at diversifying a little bit. So if you wouldn't mind joining us at this stage, then that would be great. Obviously, we've heard a little bit from you, Dean, already. You're not getting away that lightly. So we're going to ask you to join us again on stage here. Maybe dig a little bit into your own unique and, I suppose, commercial perspective to around the whole supply chain side of things and some of those potential opportunities that you started highlighting. I'm also delighted that we have Michael Colgan here, who's in charge of the Brexit unit within the Office of the Revenue Commissioners. And I suppose given the Revenue Commissioners' experience in terms of importing and export controls, I'm hoping, Michael, that you'll be able to give us some sense of how a potential customs system might be likely to be operating in the near future. And finally then, by no means least, we're joined by Padraig McEnany, or McEnany as we pronounce it in Kilkenny, who's founder and CEO of Celtic Pure, Ireland's largest independently owned water company. And as a business, I have a lot of experience of exporting to Northern Ireland and into Britain as well. So I think if anybody can tell us about the day-to-day challenges that we're facing when it comes to Brexit, I think Padraig is well suited. So I might just grab a seat here if you don't mind. And I'm hoping that we're going to keep this session as practical as we possibly can. I don't want to be asking questions for the next 40 minutes. I think much better questions will come from the floor. So, but what I might try and do is maybe just kick off a little bit. And I suppose when I was looking at the results of the barometer over the last couple of days in particular, one of the things that struck me in particular was this, I won't say sense of optimism, but sense of hope that there's potential to grow further business in the UK over the coming years. And I suppose, Padraig, maybe you in particular, with maybe a long experience in the UK market, maybe if you could talk us through what you've noticed happening in the last year in terms of your business going into the UK and how you'd maybe view the potential opportunities, if any, that may exist in the UK market, and what do we need to do maybe to access some of that opportunity if it exists.
I suppose, Padraig, not Every business differs, I suppose, and we're in the water bottling sector, which is low value, and it's expensive to ship. So, from a point of view of dealing with our customers and the buyers, there's not a lot of talk from them about the Brexit at the minute because of the uncertainty. On the certainty of it, and from a point of view of Celtic Pure, we're looking at product development, and we're looking at We're looking at bringing new products to the market at the beginning of next year. That'll help to improve our spread among and give more opportunity to break into more markets within the UK.
And in terms of when you're speaking to your customers at the moment in the UK, like, where does it sit on the agenda? Where does Brexit sit on the agenda that they have at your meetings? Is it right up at the top? I don't get the sense that it is. But
no,
where
it's not.
Does it
it's
sit?
Not. It's not at the top. And I suppose not. We're maybe reluctant to take it to the top at present because not of the uncertainty. You know, like, not, you could be taking something to the table and then regretting that not. You know, like, because you're highlighting maybe problems that mightn't occur when we talk about. When we talk about customs and duties and that, so it's a kind of hoping that not that this that the duties and levies won't occur and that not that we can grow the business, continue to grow the business with our customers.
So you're obviously trying to take that longer term view of working with that customer around the innovation piece as much as anything else to try and keep refreshing, if you like, what you have to offer and. Be planning
and
as
work
much
on,
as you can.
And work on the level of service and the quality of the product and the importance that not that we are to our customers. Like, you know, it's a, and build up as well, build up the level of trust. Mm. Trust that not that when all Brexit is all ironed out and everything that not that there'll be continuing business with Celtic Pure.
Yeah, Alison, you've obviously in an exciting phase in terms of East Coast Bakehouse, in terms of a relatively new business with large ambitions in terms of being very strong in the UK market. When I was looking at one of Tara's slides there this morning, and when I saw that, what was it, only 39% of companies had a UK-focused marketing strategy. If there are going to be opportunities in the UK, I suppose the marketing strategy that different companies adopt to try and realise those opportunities is going to be key. Could you maybe share a sense of how you're approaching it as a relatively new business going into a market that's undergoing such massive change?
Yeah, I mean, we are a relatively new business. Our first production run, I think, went down the line the day Brexit happened. So for us, it was clearly a huge shock. But I think, you know, we've got to step back and say that market has not just disappeared. It's still a market that's very suited for us in terms of the sector we're involved in, the similar taste profile. Consumers have similar preferences. So I think we have to be positive about the fact that it is still there in perhaps a changed format. We're working closely with Wordbia actually on some strategic projects with UK retailers to delve deeper and perhaps get more strategic in our approach to gap analysis, for example, with the retailers in the UK. So instead of simply going in with a similar offering, we're going in with new offerings that are based on insights on innovation and consumer requirements. So yes, it's a harder job than simply going in with the portfolio that you may have had previously. But I think ultimately that challenge is good for the business. It makes us focus much more on innovation and responding to potential needs as opposed to what's the obvious need perhaps today. Yeah. And I think for us that's been absolutely crucial. In terms of we are continuing to invest in resources on the ground in the UK. That's something that I think as a business we will continue to do, even though we are diversifying and looking at a broader footprint across the globe. To be honest, our original business plan would have looked at sort of 70% coverage for the UK. That has been ratcheted down, but it's still going to be a significant part of our business, and we have to adapt and be nimble enough to adapt to respond to what may be a slightly different need, but we believe there's absolutely a need still there.
And are you sensing, or are you seeing that openness then among customers? If you're willing to invest in insights, that category analysis piece, is there a willingness of the customer to really engage with you on that, or is there a kind of, well, let's see what you come up with approach? Is it
as a new business? Certainly, we're looking to develop those linkages over the last year, and I think anything that shows that you're more interested in your customer's business, the better. So yes, we anticipate that there will be significant positives from that strengthening of the relationship, being just more driven on getting down into the detail of their business, and that's good for both of us.
Absolutely. Jim, obviously you're in a slightly different position in some ways, given I suppose, no more than some of the other primary categories, the challenges that are faced, particularly in relation to cheddar, and the uniqueness of the UK market. It's one of the few global markets, I suppose, that currently exists for a product like cheddar cheese. So how are you seeing the UK market at this stage in terms of its current state and how you're thinking through what might lie ahead, if you like?
Yeah, the scenario is actually we have two dimensions to how we look at the UK. First of all, we have a presence in the UK and we have two manufacturing sites. So we're formatting cheese in one, which is a business-to-business arrangement, and we have the raw material coming in from Ireland predominantly for that. And then we have a manufacturing and cultured cheese business, which is sourcing products in the UK and from Ireland, but not necessarily from. So the first and foremost approach has been about minding the UK business. And that has been working with the customers in the UK, if you like, cozying up to them very much since the 23rd of June of last year. That has been about reassurance and saying, look, we are here, we're here in the long term, we have businesses here, we're working with you, we'll continue to work with you and we'll develop. And that has been that degree of comfort, in as much as it was priority, because there was all mixed views, you know, in the context of will it, won't it, and all the rest. So from that perspective, quite confident that we will, and we will grow in that business, and that's really fed into the barometer, that as a presence in the market, we will be there. What we want to make sure is that we have Irish product going in there, because we can remain in the market and have relationships with other suppliers in the UK in the context of cheddar cheese and the likes. From an Irish perspective, I suppose the biggest challenge is that while as an industry we have, you know, we've diversified from what we were in the 70s and 80s, which was predominantly a butter powder industry, into cheeses and different varieties of cheese, all the rest of it like that. So much so that today, like, that 18% of national manufacturing milk pool is going into cheddar for the British market. That's an astounding city. That's his national milk pool now I'm talking about. When it comes down to ourselves within the dairy gold context, it's the equivalent of about 30,000 tons of cheese. Rooted in two ways, direct and in partnership with Ornua. And that's the pain that's going to be, and the potential pain that's really going to impact us, because the business in the UK will thrive and prosper in a market that needs more. So from the perspective here, I think the case is well made now at this point. I mean, you know, in the context of the Department of Agriculture, Food and the Marine, Board BA here, everybody is involved in the pitch and everyone understands the extent of the problem. So it's about figuring out now, and we're at the stage, you know, the stage one and stage two that Tara spoke about this morning. We are going into that third stage, this stage. What is, where is the picture? And what's the scenario likely to be? You don't mobilise very quickly, 300 million litres of milk, in our case, into an alternative product, into another market. So the hard Brexit scenario is what we've been thinking about, and that is the appalling scenario that we can't really get our head around. So what it's doing, I suppose, is it's giving us an awful lot of, thought process going through about what, in a global market that is, say, 20 million tonnes per annum, growing at something in the region of 1.8 to 2% CAGR, what is the potential in there for alternatives? And that's the space that we're getting our heads into, but recognising from the outset that the returns from those markets aren't anything like what the return is from our next door neighbour in the distance and all the rest of it. So really that's the space that we're in, and that's why we're thinking about the worst in what we have to diversify, hoping that we won't. But I think one thing that we would be certainly clear on is that having an 18% or almost a 20% of an Irish milk pool depending on one product for one market is high risk.
And would you be of the view at this stage that it was high risk Brexit or no Brexit, that as an industry with the growth that we're seeing in the dairy sector, that diversification and looking at those alternatives is what you would have been trying to do anyway, and this is just putting a much stronger urgency on it, or what would your perspective be?
I think in hindsight, I mean, we always follow the money. You know, nature is, you know, the milk price league table is what drives a lot of behaviour, as I can tell you, in our sector anyway. So from that perspective, you know, that the most rewarding market has been that British market. And equally, from the byproduct point of view, cheddar has been the ideal for the generation of the quality whey that we need, whether it is for protein concentrates, or demineralized whey or whatever, which another industry depends on, and that's the infant formula industry. So there's two industries running parallel. That's why there is, if you like, there's a state dependency on the cheddar side. When you look at it now in different perspective and look at it in a global sense, you say, well, you know, in what has been a political decision without economic thinking, this is the kind of turmoil that we're put into. So it does, it's the shock and awe moment and saying is, what do we do with a perishable product that we have given a guarantee to our members that we'll accept whatever they'll produce? So that's the space, the spin that we're in and the space we're in at this point.
Well, thanks for that, Jim. Dean, you mentioned in your presentation the company should have a plan. Could you talk to us a little bit more about that? What should we be thinking about as part of this plan? Obviously, you've a very strong linkage with Ireland, having operations here as well as in the UK. So when you say a plan, what would you say to the companies out here in the room today that should be in that plan?
I think people should look at everything they do, really. I think we've just come through some pretty hard times in terms of recession, and those companies that are here or have been here for more than 3 years, I think it's testament to a good company. I think people should be healthier for it. They should certainly have had an idea from that process of coming up with a plan. How do you deal with a recession? Well, you look at everything in your business, really, and you look at what's making money, what's losing money. So we would encourage people not just to look inside their business, but to look outside of it. Yes, you should look at your supply chain and challenge it. Challenge your retail customers and see whether you can be part of a plan with them to improve on the way they handle your products and where it features. But equally, I'm a huge advocate of collaboration, and we are a collaborator. We work with Irish Hauliers, everything we do. We don't own a truck, we own a van, but we're handling 16,000 pallets a week, and that's it. We do that with one van, would you believe? So we link up with our retail partners and make sure that they are tuned into what we're doing, work with them and see if we can find ways of eking out supply chain advantage. In the same way, Irish producers, and we've seen this work really well, and Irish retailers as well, there's nothing wrong with our asking an Irish retailer to help you with your supply chain. They're into every postcode across the country every day, and we do this with Musgrave across the whole of the island of Ireland, so producers can access the Musgrave network very comprehensively. It's a great retail partner, and consolidating 3 points and get it across the UK then. But equally, if you've got clusters of producers that have got a common objective to get to the UK, why not share lorry space? Why not share ideas and how you can rub shoulders with each other and find out what each one is doing? Doing well, pick out the best. Mimicry is the best form of flattery, I always say. So there's loads of solutions out there, and it's not shameful to ask for help or advice, not necessarily from consultants, just from each other. So that's what I'd urge people to do.
Ask for help. It's not a bad place to start, maybe. Listen, I'm anxious to get to the audience now in a moment, but maybe Michael, before we do, obviously in your position within the Revenue Commissioners, any final customs controls that come into place, your organisation is going to be responsible for the implementation of them. So obviously a lot of this area is relatively new for a number of the food and drink companies that are in our industry. So what would you say they should be thinking about now? What steps should they be taking now to try and figure out how this might possibly look? Obviously we can't be certain, but in terms of getting their head around it, if you like, what would you recommend to any company?
That's a very valid question, and looking at it simply, customs are centre stage in this on one hand, and on the other hand they're not, in the sense that the negotiations and the deals on trade will be led by DG Trade, and on the certification issue and health issue it will be led by DG Sante. And the job of customs and the revenue commissioners will be to implement a negotiated solution, whatever that may be. And we've seen the speakers talk about the full spectrum, from single market access, which we have at the moment, to a customs regime, on the other hand, under WTO rules, where tariffs might apply. In keeping with good public administration, we're preparing for the worst, but we're hoping for the best. So in terms of traders that might be preparing for that, and we have been networking with a lot of their representative groups through our Customs Consultative Committee and other fora, and the logistics sector as well are part of that. We'd ask them to look at, specifically, number one, at what type of contracts they're negotiating forward. In other words, who's going to be responsible, have the responsibility for delivery tariffs and that. That's probably invisible at the moment if you're trading within the EU because they don't arise. I'd be looking at where are your raw materials coming from? Are they coming from within the UK or elsewhere? Have you alternatives? And where are you going to be selling to? And what will your distribution network look like? For example, if you have a hub based in the UK, after Brexit, if that distributes for you to Europe, when they move to every other member state of the EU, it will represent a customs event because they'll be crossing a border. Where if the distribution hub was here, and I know maybe in a European context we're not the centre of Europe, but there are other member states where people could locate where the distribution would be simpler, because then effectively you'd only have one customs event moving your products to the UK. Moving to the rest of the 27 wouldn't constitute a customs event at all. I'd ask traders to look at the type of simplifications that Dean mentioned there. He mentioned AEO as one, and when he mentioned it, some of his comments brought me to believe that I'm probably one of the last of the Mohicans, because I fit into that category, having been responsible for taking the customs officers off the border in 1993. I'd also ask traders to look at, to know what goods they're doing and where they fit into classification, customs classification. What is the classification code that applies to their goods? It's totally irrelevant if your shipping is at the moment to the UK. But a lot of traders who trade outside the EU are quite familiar with that because they're exporting outside the EU and they have to know that. To look at if they're going to transit goods to the UK, well, who's going to do that and how is the transit going to be affected? To look at if there's customs clearance to be done, who might do that? In our networking with some of the business sectors, it didn't show that there was a very high level, and anyway, in the feedback we got from them, it didn't show that there was a very high level of thought gone into that by some of the companies already. And we would try and we plan to do an outreach program to help people, probably at representative body level initially. But obviously we can contact all taxpayers because we own the VAT register as well, and we know who the traders are. So we would plan to do that. But we need to know more of what's coming out of the negotiating process before we can be more specific in talking to traders and their representative groups. But I think I've given some pointers there as to where traders might look.
I think there's some very useful starting points at very least. And then, as you say, as time evolves, things hopefully will become clearer. I'd like to maybe see if we have any questions from the floor. I know we have Michael, and I think there's another microphone around the floor as well. I suppose, don't be shy. There's some really good expertise at the venture. Shane, do you want to?
Hi, so I'm Shane Hamill from Board Bia. And, you know, one of the findings from the barometer that Tara presented this morning was that, you know, as companies, you can be doing all that you can to prepare for Brexit, but that doesn't mean that your supply chain partners are doing the same, and there might be a risk there. And so I'm wondering, maybe Porik, Alison as well, you know, is this something that you've seen, whether it's your input suppliers or anything else, any other aspects of your business, that actually there may be risks evolving there as well?
Well, in 2016, almost 100% of our raw materials was coming from the UK, and we looked at it after Brexit, and we said that we were very heavily exposed, and we started looking around to see what suppliers. There's no preformed suppliers in the 26 counties of Ireland, so to make the manufacture, we manufacture all our own bottles on site, so that wasn't an option. We looked at our cap suppliers, and there was a company in Bray that was after being bought out by United Caps, and we started. They had been in with us before that, showing samples and different things, but we hadn't done any business with them. And within the 12 months, we have moved over all our sports caps to Bray. Now we intend at the end of the year to have fully completed all our caps, so that we will be buying about 120 million caps this year from United Caps and Bray. So we've reduced the risk. We've reduced the risk there. We've also we had a very good relationship with our preform supplier in the UK, and we have. I had meetings with them both at the factory and over in the plant in Wrexham, and we're trying to convince them to open a plant in the 26 counties to manufacture preforms, because not we have a 4-year contract with them, which we signed at the end of last year, and we're saying to them that not there's an opportunity there, and if they don't take it, that somebody else could, and then we would save a lot of money on transport. So from that's mainly the areas we're looking at trying to both reduce our cost in transport, reduce if there's customs, reduce time implications, and also still holding on to the quality of the product. That mainly what we're doing in terms of supply chain coming into the factory.
Alison, what would your thoughts be on it?
We would source as many of our inputs as possible in Ireland, so we're using Irish butter and Irish oats, but for many of our products, inputs are sourced from the UK, but they are mainly internationally traded commodities. So we would have ready alternatives across the EU for sugar, for chocolate, for palm oil, other alternatives. So, you know, there's a natural hedge at the moment on the currency issue, as in sourcing in the UK, and that's beneficial. But if the worst case scenario does come to pass, we do and we have looked at alternatives across Europe in other markets and further afield. So it's something that we are conscious of. But for us on the supply chain piece, you know, I think we should be okay. Really, the resources issue for us is going to be on managing the customs aspects if that comes into being. We participated in the Borbia Barometer, and there's no question it showed glaring gaps in our capabilities to deal with many of the areas in terms of expertise and the human resources side. And I think that's the real challenge for us as an SME, to start investing in those areas. Even though we may not need them, and that's a real challenge for SMEs, to make investment in areas that may show no benefits. And you know, it's that kind of ironic situation. If they show no benefits, it's because we're in a better place. But we will have to put resources into managing those issues.
Thanks, Alison. Do we have any other questions there? It's down the back there, I think.
Good afternoon, Patrick McCluskey from McCluskey's Bakery. Just a quick question for either Dean or Michael. I'm just wondering, in your experience, do SMEs use facilitators for custom clearance? And if so, roughly, what's the cost of that?
I could go on if you wanted. Generally, the bigger companies try to have in-house solutions. SMEs generally rely on customs agents or brokers, and there's in the region of about 165 of those who are registered with revenue and who transact regular business with customs. So that would be the community out of which you would be picking a representative or an agent. Yes, they charge for their services, but they're in business and they can negotiate a business arrangement based on the number of transactions you will be doing and sort of the usual business criteria. If you're doing a lot of transactions, you're going to get your service a lot cheaper than someone looking at a once-off event. Also, of your line items, if you know what I mean, the different commodities, if you just are trading in one commodity, it's a relatively simple declaration because there's just one commodity code to be inserted. But if you were doing multiple lines, your declaration would become more complicated, and you could expect then that they would charge a commensurately higher fee for doing that. I'd expect the industry will be expanding as well, and that the numbers that we're talking about at the moment, post-Brexit, might be a larger community.
Okay. Dean, do you have anything to add to that? Or?
Well, it's obviously going to depend on what roles we're working to, really, but I think when we outsourced it ourselves on behalf of clients we work with, you're talking 20-odd pound a transaction for low-level transactions, but I think it's going to have to come down to the £1 or £2
for it to stand any chance of succeeding, because a lot of the movements are quite small, a lot of the transactions are quite small, so otherwise it'd be massively prohibitive for producers.
So if it doesn't come down, it could be a very big challenge.
Well, yeah, very much so.
Absolutely.
Huge.
If I could make an added comment there, that the cost of that type of clearance, if you're in a small way of trade and you're exporting small consignments, relatively speaking, your cost then will be higher than someone that's exporting large loads of several containers at a time. That can be still just the one declaration. But if you're exporting small items, your cost would be relatively dearer. And I would say as well, Dean mentioned earlier, he mentioned authorised economic operators. I think there's around 133 of those registered with revenue at present, and traders should look at those as options. Probably more viable for the larger type traders than the smaller ones. But there are other simplifications that are available to companies to become authorised consignors or consignees, which effectively takes the control element of any business potentially away from the frontier and to temporary storage premises approved and bonded by revenue. So that's an option. Looking at AAOs briefly, I think they account for something like between 80 and 90% of import declarations that we process presently. We process 1.3 million of those annually, and we anticipate there could be quite an increase in that number when we try and project ahead.
Thanks, Michael. Any further questions? Down the back, Catherine.
Thank you. Catherine Lasky, head of the Irish Farmers Association. From the three exporters, I think the message that came very loud and clear to me was their determination to post-Brexit or in the transition period to remain very solidly involved in their export to the UK. I'm just wondering, to what extent does their strategy include exploring alternative markets within the EU, outside the EU, and what are the challenges that they've identified on that? Thanks.
I don't know, Jim, do you want to start at that one, maybe?
Hi, Catherine.
Probably answered this before.
At least you didn't come at us on milk price and this. I suppose next phase, yeah. Yeah, I think from the point of view is like there's no doubt. I mean, you're correct. The context of the determination to stay in the market and to work the market and services, because you know language, everything is good about it. The taste, you know, the same palate, all the rest of it like that. So that's right. I suppose at this point, the exploration is yes. I mean, we're committed. We're committed as an industry actually. Because we've sat down with the Department of Agriculture, Food and the Marine, with Aidan and Brendan, with Tara and with Padraig and others collectively. Because in the context of the exposure, actually, from an Irish point of view, there's actually only four manufacturers of cheddar. So it's not a widespread, diverse group of people with all different ideas. So everybody is in the same patch, as it were. So it's not a complex table in terms of numbers. And we've got to explore that opportunity. We've got to explore it from an industry perspective because of the scale of it. The challenges that we're instantly faced is in looking at the markets and looking at that cheese piece and the growth globally is that the greatest growth is in the farthest markets, you know, by and large. And different types of cheeses, that the technology that we, you know, are we suitable today for that and all that. There's stuff going on in that to try and analyse all of that. Before we even get to the market return piece. So our head is in that space. Now, that will all be weighed up, of course, against the background of saying, during these negotiations, if we move away from WTO tariffs, and you know, you'll be balancing that then again back into the return scene. But I think what it has done is it has been the shock, if you like, that we need to think differently, that we need to explore differently, and that we are now in the post-quota era, that we are playing in a global stage. And that point, if you like, has been, I suppose, has been more of a wake-up call, if you like, to us. So I think a lot of action going on, but too early to judge what will be the outcome of that, except to say that I could assure from an industry point of view or from a farming community point of view is that all the players are committed to doing the right thing in the interests of Ireland Inc., and whatever that will be at the end of it. But, you know, all state agencies working with industry is where we are, and that in itself has been a significant achievement. Because the fourth point was the making everyone aware of the challenge. And I think once you know what the challenge is, then you go into a different phase and you become more exploratory of alternatives, and then you find, you arrive at maybe solutions.
Thinking about that diversification piece then, Jim, and you mentioned about exploring differently. What do you mean by exploring differently? So if there's other companies in the room that are now trying to look not only to defend the UK but also to diversify, I'm sure most are. What do you mean by explore differently? What do we need to do that we haven't done in the past, maybe?
Well, I think, you know, from the point of view of the evolving food industry, for example, I mean, from our point of view, is it's only when we stood back and look at it, and, you know, we often take cheese for granted, but cheese will start at the breakfast table in the morning, and you can have it at any meal during the day, right through the evening, and in fine dining, it's the last plate that will be brought to the table. So from that perspective, just thinking of that in the context of, so fortunately, that's the arena that at least we were dealing in. Yeah. Secondly, if we look at the trends and, you know, the consumption and the growth, and the food to go, on the go, the slice of pizza, you know, all of that, that area is the fastest growing area from a point of view of actually growth. And equally in that, in the context of exploring differently, is thinking about what is happening in the emerging markets. Because we've all been focused on the emerging markets from the likes of infant formula and powders and, you know, basic nutrition. But parallel with that, the emerging markets are actually growing equally because they're becoming more affluent. They're becoming more on the issue of pizza toppings, the mozzarella arena and all that. So we have to think, we're thinking differently in that. So it is really, if you like, that moment of where the reality and the reality of the hard Brexit scenario dawns on you, it really shocks you into thinking broader. So I think, you know, people just need to do a bit of more brainstorming, stand back from it, get the help, get the assistance of Borbia, of whoever, in order to actually, you know, come with a whole lot of daft solutions maybe initially, and then obviously emerge out of that with maybe more concrete proposals.
Thanks, Jim. We have time for one or two more questions from the floor. I know I have a couple. Anne, sorry, down the back there.
Thank you, Borg. I have a question from Michael. It's a much, probably a bit more practical question. I mean, we're looking at, in terms of increased customs procedures, I noted that Revenue, I think, gave a reference to maybe tenfold increase in export declarations post-Brexit in a hard Brexit scenario. I think for some of us, and this may be for the larger companies, but from some of us, we have an export declaration, but we equally will have an import declaration on the UK side as well. So it's a double process. In the context of simplification and streamlining and moving to more electronic declarations and all that good stuff that we will have to do, is Revenue considering, or is it a possibility that we could have sort of a one shop sort of solution to both the import and the export declarations, and maybe try and streamline and simplify that process for us all? Thank you.
Okay, and talk firstly about the volumes you mentioned. We thought initially when we scoped out the volumes that if we would experience maybe a fivefold increase in declarations, that would be sufficient in terms of our systems development. And our work since the Brexit get-go has brought us into contact with a lot of traders who have no customs footprint at the moment and who import lots of small items. And in fact, one of those traders had 3.5 times our volume, our current volume, for one business alone. So we're looking in scoping it up, we're looking at scoping it at by a factor of 20 and higher even. Obviously with those traders, we're trying to create scenarios where controls would be away from the frontier, and the customs code makes provision for that. But we can't make any assumptions as to what might happen. You're talking then about joint controls or joined up border issues. Part of the negotiation process will essentially involve a cooperation agreement between the EU and the UK, and arrangements like that with regard to possible joint processing could be included in that scenario. Those things haven't figured as actively yet, but they're part of our asks, if you would like it that way, that we want to see an administrative cooperation agreement with the UK, because on their leaving the EU, they drop out of the current intra-EU cooperation arrangements, and that was one of the things we identified early on. So that type of cooperation is on the agenda and has been thought of.
Great, thanks, Michael. I suppose, sorry, your question down the back?
Just one question on VAT. Yeah. It's the one that worries me most. What happens if you send something into the UK, 20% VAT at the point of entry, the customer doesn't want to pick up the 20%? How do you get the 20% back?
Okay, well, whatever arrangement, the UK will have to rewrite its customs code. That's the first thing. They share a customs code with the 28 at the moment, but when they leave, I suppose they could opt to keep it if they wanted, but one thinks they will negotiate their own, and they're going to write a customs act. So the person generally responsible for the payment of VAT is the importer, generally. And the importer is in a position normally to recoup the VAT paid at import in the normal VAT tree return. That's the way it happens at the moment, and I presume that the UK would operate that a regime like that into the future. They do it at the moment. The customs code is actually silent on that amount. VAT doesn't have to be collected at import. It's national legislation that underpins that. But VAT effectively is not, it's a neutral issue at the end of the day. But if you're paying VAT up front, it is a cash flow issue. And the normal thing is that there's a declaration made by a declarant, an agent, like we spoke about. The importer then is in a position to recoup the VAT.
Is it realistic to expect the your customer to come up with 20% of all your exports every month and wait for them to have a cash flow implication themselves to recover it? Or is the possibility for the Irish person to actually register for VAT in the UK? And if so, what is the likely arrangement around that?
The normal possibility is for an importer, they can set up a fiscal representative or an agent over there to do that. And I'm talking in the context of my knowledge of how we operate, and I'm presuming a similar arrangement will apply in the UK, that can be done. But the normal event is that the importer pays the VAT and recoups it. And it's not that they're going to escape the VAT. At the moment, there's no VAT on intra-community supply and acquisition. That's what happens at the moment. If goods move between any two member states, there's a zero rate applying to that. But when the person who receives that, the distributor or importer, passes it on or sells it, VAT at the normal rate, 23 in our case, is charged on that. So at the end of the day, the consumer pays the 23%. It's immaterial in the greater scheme of things whether the VAT is paid up front or not, because the importer will recoup the 23% in his return, and the additional 23% will only be on the value-added margin that he is attributed to the supply. So it's cash flow problem, potentially, but it's revenue neutral. And
that can be quite significant at the time.
It can be significant because traders are not used to doing it at the moment, and the single market has created an environment where the goods move at zero rate and they're accounted for in the internal returns. But the customs regime may collect the VAT up front. The UK may choose not to collect VAT up front. That's their prerogative.
Yeah.
We don't know what they will
do. They'll have to play out in time.
They're free to do that.
But I suppose just maybe I'm conscious of the time that we're coming to the close. We've talked a nice bit about the UK, and we've talked about diversifying. I'm just thinking about the Ireland market, and in terms of obviously the importance of it for many of the food and drink companies that we have. I don't know, Alison, you obviously have a lot of experience in the local market in terms of what do you see in terms of business development, maybe opportunities or challenges on the domestic market?
Well, I mean, we've talked about the worst case scenario, and if the worst case scenario is tariffs and that regime, it is a two-way street, and I think it's always important to remember that. So depending on the category that you're operating in, we're operating in the biscuit category, of which 99% of product is currently imported. So of that 220, 230 million euros worth of biscuits that are consumed in Ireland every year, and 99% of that is imported. So for us, there is an opportunity there whereby that 99% of imports will, in a hard Brexit scenario, experience tariffs of between 9 and 23%, we don't know yet. So there is an opportunity there for us to create a better local market position to import, substitute, but really to create a better position for our brands in this market. And I think for many Irish producers, that opportunity is there. Maybe not at those levels in terms of the 99%, but there is an opportunity to build on the board be a message of local provenance, quality, sustainability, and all of those really good credentials that we have as food producers. And I think, you know, we need to balance that potential positivity with what may be very negative issues on the export side. So for us, I think, you know, we're hoping it doesn't happen, but if it does happen, there are some positives for us.
Well, certainly for you, the Ireland market is a key part of your strategy.
Absolutely,
a key part, and many companies like you, I'm sure. Listen, I'm just conscious of time, but I suppose there was one thing maybe just to finish up. We've heard an awful lot of details this morning and a lot of advice and a lot of, I suppose, speculation maybe in some senses, because that's all it can be. But maybe just to finish up, I must ask each of you, for the food and drink companies in the room and obviously on the live stream as well, if there was one thing, one piece of advice that you give them that they should be doing immediately in their business to try and get their heads ready, if you like, for what's coming down the track, what would it be? Maybe, Parag, if I'd start with you, seeing as you're...
Well, we definitely, in our company... cost is definitely it's a high volume product, and it is low value. So from a production point of view, we're definitely looking at cost. We launched 17 to 18 million investment last year in the plant to reduce our costs, putting in new machinery that will also produce value added products. But in term, until we definitely know what way Brexit is going to go, it's look at your costs, look at your production, your KPIs, see what we're talking about. 10%, we're talking about 15-20%. You know, there could be 10% there in our production that we could take out, so that at least not we weren't on the back foot when Brexit does eventually. We eventually know the outcome of Brexit, so that's possibly what my take on what we're doing, product development and looking at costs and investing in machinery, really, you know. So.
Key areas, Dean, from your point of view, what would you say?
Yeah, I'd just say get that plan going and look at all parts of your supply chain in your business, outside of your business, amongst your competitors and friends, and get into the UK and ask for help.
Thank
you, Dean. Jim? Yeah, just I think first and foremost is that every company, and from the smallest of SME upwards, should complete the Brexit Barometer, the Brexit Navigator, or the Brexit Scorecard, because that's your first, that's your health check.
Yes.
And when you see reds and oranges in that health check, well, clearly that's the area to focus on.
Yes.
And even if Brexit doesn't happen, what it does do is alert you to business challenges you're going to have anyway.
Absolutely.
But Brexit has been the one, the catalyst that has brought your attention to it. So for goodness sake, everybody should do the Barometer, the Scorecard, the Navigator. There's so many tools out there. We have done a number of them because we've been cross-referencing, and that's no disrespect to the Barometer, but the answers are still the same. The reds are the reds.
Thanks for that, Jim. I was just about to give you a 20 when you mentioned the Barometer, but when you mentioned the other tools, unfortunately, can't do that, I'm afraid. Alison, what would you recommend?
I think really the challenge is to take this opportunity to diversify into new markets and to kickstart that process in your business. Whether Brexit happens or not, it is an opportunity that will force us to refocus and diversify, and that's good for our businesses, regardless of whether Brexit happens or not.
Thank you, Alison. Michael, finally for you, last word.
I endorse what the previous speakers have said. I think you need to look at your processes from the time you have your first raw material product to the final product you make and the money you get from that, and then to look where Brexit could potentially impact on any level in that, and then to make a contingency plan on the basis of what you might need to do to meet the challenge of Brexit. We're preparing as best we can. We're hoping we'll have favourable decisions in relation to tariffs and barriers, as the Minister said. But our preparations have to enable us to be Brexit ready in 2 years' time.
So I think there's lots of, thank you, Michael, lots of really solid advice and guidance there, I think. And I suppose I'd just like to thank everybody on the panel, Padraig, Dean, Jim, Allison and Michael, for the openness and I suppose depth that you were able to go into in your answers today. I think is really useful for everybody in the audience and that have tuned in, just to hear your own perspectives, because nobody has all the answers here. We're all in the same sort of challenges that we're facing, but to hear the different ways that you're trying to assess or deal with, or at least analyse what has to be done, taking that kind of data-driven approach, getting your strategy right, how you go about thinking of the imponderables that are there and the various scenarios that are there. I think that's really solid advice for anybody. So I'd just like maybe to ask the audience to join with me and thank them for the contribution that they've made.